Hello, and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where we have two things to talk about. Of course, we gotta discuss Disney Plus's Hamilton, but also movie theaters, once struggling to survive, now they're fighting to survive. Let's discuss. So every year, there are a couple of holidays that Disney just owns. Thanksgiving, the first weekend of summer, you know, the first weekend of May. And the 4th of July. Now, they usually very generously give that date to a studio they're working with. The Spider-Man movies have previously opened in that window, and this year it was supposed to be their recent Fox acquisition, Free Guy. What a show of support to Ryan Reynolds. I hope he does as well in December, where his movie is now currently supposed to open. We'll see! But anyway, thanks to coronavirus, of course, Disney had to pivot to streaming with mega pop culture event Hamilton, which they had planned to release in theaters. Although it seems, I think, like a perfect streaming event, quite frankly, rather than a theatrical release. We're going to talk about a potential movie, don't worry. So how did Hamilton do? Nobody knows! That's the problem with streaming services. Or is that the benefit from the studio's perspective? They bring in tons of money if they're done right. Warner Brothers is like, where's our tons of money? But they're supposed to bring in tons of money, and you don't have to report any of the numbers. You don't have to report it to the public. You don't have to report it to agents and give people, you know, like talent a cut of the profits. Nobody knows. It goes into a black hole, or really the black hole that is the pocketbook of, you know, these studios. Not only are digital numbers private, but it becomes even more complicated when you have a streaming service and people are paying a subscription price rather than for specific content. How much of a fraction of a subscription price belongs to said project? What can they say they're responsible for? It's really a game, as we've discussed before, of keeping people subscribed, especially with the proliferation of streaming services. People can only subscribe to so many. So the name of the game is keeping people subscribed. I told you before, and I'll remind you, that's one of the reasons that sometimes shows that are popular get canceled, because they're not bringing in any new subscribers. So the service says, this isn't driving business, and we think these people, other people will, who like the show will stay subscribed anyway. It's a tough game, and it's a different outlook. You have to really think of a different strategy as to, you know, programming. So it's fascinating. But it's all done behind closed doors. Here's what we do now. Number one, people tweeted about Hamilton like crazy, especially on Friday when it debuted on the service. So PR-wise, big win for Disney. People seemed particularly taken with my two favorites, David Diggs and Jonathan Groff, while Philippa Sue's Eliza also trended. Number two, Variety reported that over the weekend, you can't tell how a service is doing, but you can tell how it's doing in terms of downloads online. So that's a very interesting kind of roundabout way to see how, you know, if something's a success. And this is quite the headline. As you can see, the Disney Plus app downloads jumped an eye-popping 74% over the three-day period. And that's, by the way, worldwide. Well, where Disney Plus is available. It's not available all over the world, but it is available in a number of countries. So that means those people are probably new subscribers. You're not going to download an app that you're already using. Plus, Disney very shrewdly, as has Netflix, has done away with their free trial. So if you download it and you want to use it, you got to pay for it. But Disney Plus still continues to be dirt cheap. It's a mere $6.99 a month, or $70 for the full year. Just think about that. You could subscribe for just the month for Hamilton for $6.99, and that's way cheaper than what Universal is costing, charging to rent a movie over on iTunes, you know, around $20. So we'll see. I mean, Disney's getting a lot of attention and a big audience, but are they taking too big a hit financially? Because they're to some degree giving it away. Now, Disney, speaking of financials, will have to deliver its next fiscal report August 4th. It's expected to be a doozy, because this is the one that's fully within the coronavirus pandemic quarantine time period. I'm looking forward to it. It'll be interesting. And they'll have to, as part of that report, give, I would assume, a new subscriber count for Disney Plus. Last we checked, there were somewhere around 55 million subscribers total worldwide. And so when we get a new subscriber count, we'll also have an idea of how much money's being pulled in. But remember, they're also spending so much money on Disney Plus to make the shows, to run it, to advertise it, it's still not expected to be profitable for several years. But it wasn't all great news for Hamilton, no sir, as the Academy announced that filmed stage productions are not eligible for the Oscars, even if Disney again had originally intended to release Hamilton in theaters. Apparently, though, Hamilton can still go for the Emmys, but only as a variety special, not a TV movie. I think that makes sense, quite frankly. I know it might be disappointing to the fan in some of you, but I think if you like put on your Academy or Emmy hat, you're like, yeah, that's what it is. And Hamilton already has 11 Tonys, as well as a Pulitzer and a Grammy. That's a pretty nice awards cabinet. So I think this just gives Disney more incentive to do a proper film adaptation further down the line. However, now that we've all seen Hamilton thanks to Disney+, maybe a way to make the movie version of Hamilton seem fresh creatively, both to audiences and to the industry and awards voters, would be to change up the cast. Now, I know that seems sacrilegious to some of you, but I think it makes sense, especially as it would be a way to kind of replace Lin-Manuel Miranda. With all due respect, but I think everyone agreed, I think almost every reviewer said that, you know, while he deserves credit for coming up with the show, he is the weakest performer in the cast. I think a new cast, I mean, all the original cast has already gotten so much attention out of this and other work, not as much work as maybe we'd like, but they did get a tremendous boost. I think that a new cast with bigger star power would be a reason for fans, especially casual fans, to pay to see the production again in theaters. What do you think? If Disney remakes Hamilton as a proper film with locations and all that stuff, would you want the exact same cast? Or would you like to see somebody new? And who would you cast? I think it's interesting. Think about it. You could put Beyoncé and Janelle Monáe as the Schuyler sisters. I think there's potential there to, you know, as I said, it's more about just getting people to take another look at it, especially from an awards perspective. I mean, this cast has already gotten all the awards they can possibly get, I think, for what they've done. Deservedly so. All right, so while you're stewing over that suggestion, that's the studio suit in me. Now you can see how studio suit decisions are made. You have what you want to do as the fan, but I need to get people to pay to see this again, and I need awards voters to take it seriously and make it competitive against fresh content that no one's ever seen before. Think about it. All right, so anyway, as for when movies will be able to play in theaters again, we still don't have a clear answer. Oh, still a horror. It's getting aggressively bad. So the UK has allowed theaters to open, but only 50 of them have done so because they're mostly waiting on new movies just like US theaters are. However, the UK government just passed a $2 billion rescue package for the country's theaters, not just movies, but also for the performing arts. That's to sustain them financially. I think that's great. It would be wonderful if we would do something like that for our movie theaters, particularly the independent ones, and also our performing arts venues as well. Like, not just Broadway, but across the country. I don't know if we're going to do that, though. We'll see. Now, many states have allowed movie theaters to reopen at reduced capacity. But Los Angeles and the tri-state area, the biggest movie-going cities, and San Francisco, but Los Angeles and the tri-state area are really the biggest movie-going places in the country. They still have no set date of return at all. Nobody knows when they're going to open, not even the government. They're like, we don't know. And theater owners are so anxious that the New Jersey branch of NATO, the National Association of Theater Owners, is suing their state government. They're taking them to court. AMC, Cinemark, and Regal have signed on to the lawsuit, and they're arguing that if churches can reopen, so should movie theaters. Which I have to say makes sense, because both are large groups seated in a closed space for a few hours. The only difference is that, one, the lights are turned out, and that, of course, doesn't affect the virus. Now, I think it's pretty obvious that churches were allowed to reopen because of, you know, religion. But instead of allowing movie theaters to also open, after being presented with this argument, I would close churches back up. I would say, you could have church outside. It's like a drive-in church. You could have a drive-in church. Go do that. But I would probably say that you couldn't. I'd be like, I'm sorry, because everybody else is using it as an excuse to open up their places. Now, we'll see what the New Jersey courts decide. If they side with movie theaters, that'll set a precedent. Well, it'll set a precedent either way. But if they side with movie theaters, that'll set the kind of precedent that will get similar lawsuits, I think, filed in New York City and Los Angeles. I mean, NATO's got to do what NATO's got to do. But I hope the judge does what the judge's got to do. As for what people are streaming right now, sales continue to drive traffic on iTunes because people, you know, particularly right now, are eager to save some money while they watch some content. Also, it's interesting to me because you can watch. I keep promising myself that I'm going to watch stuff for free on the streaming services I already pay for, but then I'm like, oh, but I really want to watch this specific movie, and then I go and I pay for it specifically a la carte on iTunes. It's frustrating. I spend a lot of money on entertainment at this point. Anyway, Universal is also still doing strong business digitally, while independent military flick The Outpost has shot to number one. That's Orlando Bloom in the middle there. Orlando Bloom! That's on Scott Eastwood next to him. Interesting cast. And Mel Gibson continues to be a draw on streaming, with his latest movie, Force of Nature, also doing well. He's third listed, though. I don't know if he's the star, but he's the star of the poster. Over on Disney Plus, of course, Hamilton is number one, as you'd expect, while Fox's last Ice Age movie, which just debuted on the service, has also popped into the top 10. Meanwhile, Netflix continues to dominate with its constant flow of original content. I don't know where they get it from. They seem to have a bottomless pit of original content. 5 of the top 6 Netflix on the Netflix top 10 are Netflix originals, and 4 of them debuted just this week, which shows how hungry viewers are for fresh programming. I watched Warrior Nun, did not care for it. I didn't care for it so much I didn't review it. I don't know if it was going to do that well on the service. Maybe I should, you know, it's tough to figure out what to review and what not to review. I did not like it. I would like to watch Babysitter's Club. Is anyone watching that? I'm curious if you guys are checking any of this stuff out. I also didn't get to Desperados. There's like so much content coming out. And on that note, here's some more for this week. Tomorrow, Netflix debuts the Cate Blanchett-produced Stateless about immigration in Australia. Then on Thursday, HBO Max will debut Amy Schumer's documentary about her difficult pregnancy, balancing it with her comedy career. And then on Friday, Netflix debuts Zac Efron's new docuseries, which is the one that made him sick. Remember last year where he was like really, really sick? And then he was like, don't worry guys, I'm okay. But he like legitimately got sick. And then on Friday, it's also raining movies. Netflix's The Old Guard, Apple TV's Greyhound, and Hulu's Palm Springs. Not to mention over on iTunes, you can purchase Donnie Yen's recent action comedy. So that's this week's Movie Math. What are you watching? What are you planning to watch? What do you think of how Hamilton went down? Did you watch it? What did you think? Would you categorize it as a success for Disney? What do you think of a Hamilton movie in the near future, or at least somewhat near future? And also, what do you think about the movie theater situation, the way it's developing? Share your thoughts down below, subscribe today, and of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.